This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Historical Vignettes, Second Series. Author, Bernard Capes. Year, 1912. Topic, Dead Man's Plaque. Elfrida, wife of Athelwold, the king's favorite, and daughter and heiress to Olgar, Earl of Devonshire, was a beauty of the true Helena complexion. To see her for most men was to covet, to possess her for the one was to wear a crown of exquisite thorns. The orchard needs most watching when the fruit is ripe, and Elfrida hung at perpetual ripeness, maddening to parched lips without. The keeper of this garden of sweet things might hardly enjoy it for his fear of robbers. And the worst of it was that, to maintain so ravishing a possession in its perfection, no warning as to its own irresistible witchery must be so much as hinted to it, lest the blue innocence of two of the most lovely wondering eyes in the world should be impaired thereby, and self-consciousness usurp in them the place of naivete. Gazing into those artless depths, if one had the privilege, one presently recognized in their little floating motes and shadows the souls of the many who had drowned themselves therein. Was Elfrida conscious of the tragic secrets hidden away under those azure waters? Her husband at least thought her the most loving, the most unsophisticated, the most trustworthy of wives, and if the wish was very particularly the father to the thought was none the less for that sincere. One noon the young wife sat, yawning and a little ennuyée, in her bower of the Thanage House by Harewood Forest in Hampshire. Athelwold was with the court at Winchester, and time hung heavy on her hands. She leaned back in her seat, listlessly conning the crumpled figure of Dowcan, the Earl's clerk or booksman, as he squatted on his stool, monotonously mouthing the canons of Eusebius from an illuminated manuscript, the light literature of England when Dunstan was primate. Like many ethereal women, Elfrida found a fascination in the deformed and grotesque. She petted little harsh Dowcan, and he, while he took his full sardonic change of the license allowed him, forever in spirit kissed the beautiful feet that trampled on his soul. So, he thought, must feel the writhing, adoring, hopeless serpent under Mary's feet in the chapel. She broke in upon his reading, suddenly and irrelevantly. "Will our Lord return this night, think you, Master Booksman?" The dwarf, closing the manuscript, accepted grimly the moral of his own eloquence. "Will a star shoot out of the east?" he said. "I'll tell thee when the night hath come and gone." "Nay, say that you think he will, say it, say it." "The king loves the Earl lady, and thou desirest him. Which passion shall pull the stronger?" "Do not I love him, thou toad?" "Well then pull, and in double harness, so belike the king that holds to him shall be drawn too." "I do not desire the king." "God give him strength to bear it." She laughed musically, insolent, and so fell into thought. "Thou knowest, Dowcan," she said presently, "I have never been to court nor desired it indeed. Of what complexion is the king?" "Hot." "Is he not very young?" "He hath learned to lisp and help himself to what he wants. The young husbands in his suite observe discretion." "Poor husbands. Oh, Dowcan, oh, waily me, how the day loiters. If my love could draw so strong, I'd e'en take the worser for the better sake." "Which first?" "Peaceful." "Well, the comfort is the king's heard of thee and heard enough to satisfy him, it seems. He'll not trouble thee with a visit."
"He has not heard."
"What? Did he not use his influence with the Earl thy father to promote this match?" "Aye, on grounds of policy and fortune. Thank heaven I am not beautiful. It listens and will record." She sighed, "Alack, a doleful day. Oh, I wish my lord would come." A bugle sounding without answered on her word. There was a thud of racing hoofs, a sudden turmoil in the court, a mingling of many voices, servile or peremptory. Elfrida rose ecstatic, clasping her hands. "'Tis he himself," she cried, and advancing as the curtain parted, almost ran into the arms of her husband Athelwold. He was tall, sinewy, pale-haired and lashed. His tunic of fine cramoisy was torn, his gold garters trailed, he looked like a man in the last extreme of haste and agitation.
He took the wondering beauty in his arms and gazed into her face searchingly, passionately. "Wife," he said, "I have something of wild urgency for thy ear. I must speak it ere my blood cools. Tell me that thy heart is mine." "Athelwold."
"What questions?"
"Tell it, tell it."
"Am I not thy wife?"
"Priest's business. I speak of love.
Why did I not swear to love thee?"
"Elfrida, thy love's my heaven, without it, hell. Hear my confession. There's no moment to lose.
Thou strange husband.
When I first saw thee in thy father's house, I saw my destiny. Such immortal beauty, child, God, I was just man. Forgive the mad, cunning jealousy that would deceive thee even in thyself. I must possess, I thought, this immortal thing or die. I bid for thy rank, thy fortune in pretense, the king upholding my suit. His interest turned the scale, and we were wed. Elfrida, wife, dear love, I wronged the king in all, I was no more at first than his deputy for thy hand." A little spot of white had come to her cheek, but she smiled on him, not stirring.
"How, Athelwold?"
"I must confess it," he said. Edgar had heard speak of this lovely Devon rose, and toying only half inclined with the thought of matrimony, sent me on some feigned mission to discover if the lady's beauty really matched her nobility, in which case.
"Yes, Athelwold?"
He held her convulsively. "Oh, forgive me, Elfrida, that I made thee queen of love, not England. Thy wealth, thy name," I told him, "were the charms that gilded servile eyes, enough perhaps for such as I, but for him lacking the first and best of recommendations. And he believed me, and yielded thee to me. And now," he held her from him, his chest heaving, his voice breaking, "my sin hath found me out, someone hath betrayed me, and he is coming in person to put my report to the proof." Feigning to prepare for his visit, I fled but in time to forestall him by a few hours. "Ah, love, all is lost unless thou lovest me." She answered quite softly, "What am I to do, Athelwold?"
"Do, be anything but Elfrida. Dress slovenly, speak rudely, soil and discredit thine own perfection.
Substitute another for thy lady." They both started, and fell apart. The dwarf, forgotten by the one, unnoticed by the other, had risen from his stool. The thane's hand whipped furiously to his sword hilt. "Nay," said the girl, interposing, "Dauken is my dog, Dauken loves me, Dauken shall speak." "Let the thane," said the dwarf, cool and caustic, "seek his couch on pretense of fever and let Alcee the cookmaid receive the king. We be all devoted servants of our house. A little persuasion, a little guile, and the thing is carried."
"I will go instruct the wench," said Elfrida hurriedly.
She seemed charmed with the idea. She drove her lord to his hiding, with a peremptory laughing injunction that he was not to issue therefrom until summoned by herself. She refused to linger a moment by his side in her excitement. Her eyes had never looked so heavenly bright and blue. At eve came the king, with a little brilliant retinue. But Alcee did not receive him. Instead there advanced, and knelt at his feet, one of the most radiant young beauties his eyes had ever encountered. The violet Saxon hood fell back from her face as she raised it, revealing a sun of little curls bound by a golden fillet. The slender lifted hands, the bright parted lips, most of all the eyes, blue as lazulite and wide with innocence, seemed all as if posed for a picture of love's ecstasy. The king, young and lustful and handsome with his strong, clean-cut face, stood the speechless one. "Welcome, Lord King," she said in a half-articulate voice, like a child murmuring a lesson. He raised and kissed her. "Welcome, wife of Athelwold," he said, and let out a sigh like a man restored from drowning. But apart stood the dwarf, amazed and sorrowful. "She hath deceived us," he thought. "What is to be the end?" That night was spent in feasting, and in the morning came Elfrida to her husband's couch. Worn with fatigue and anxiety, since she had given orders that none was to approach him, he had fallen asleep at last. "Up, up, my thane," she cried. "The king is bent on hunting, and awaits thee in the court. Say nothing. All goes well." She would not linger, lest, as she whispered, she should risk discovery, but running from him, sought her bower. There, listening, a hand upon her bosom, she heard the chase ride forth, and presently the dwarf stole into her. "Thou hast done it," he said. "The king will kill him." She began, "Dog. Thou darest," but checking herself, put her hands a moment to her face, then went up and down, like one distracted. "Well, he wronged the king," said Dawkin. She stopped before him, and his soul struggled against the fascination of the blue waters. "What was that to his wrong of me?" she said passionately, and as he gazed, he saw the waters brim. "Oh, Dawkin," she wept, "cannot you understand me?" "Yes," he said. "And love me still?" "I can love the truth," he said with a heartbroken sigh. "I have found it at last in the depths I have studied so long." When the king returned, the sternness of his white face belied his uttered commiseration. The thane, he told his lady, had stumbled on his own boar spear and met with a mortal hurt. "Long live the queen," said Dawkin. Edgar started, and his hand went to his dagger. Elfrida stumbled forward. "No," she said in a weak voice, "it is my dog, Lord King. I will not have him killed because he barks." Topic: Fair Rosamond. A lady, accompanied by a small armed retinue, rode out of a forest glade near Woodstock, and pausing beside the waters of the Glimy, which here came sliding in a little weir, smooth as a barrel of glass, over an artificial dam, reined in her steed, and sat gazing in the full glow of noon upon the scene before her. It was a scene of perfect pastoral quiet, woodland and meadow as far as the eye could reach, broken by green hillocks and dominated by a solitary keep of stone set on a leafy height in the foreground. To the right, a film of floating vapor showed where a hidden hamlet smoked. There was no other token of human life or habitation anywhere. The lady, halting a little in advance of her party, made a preoccupied motion with her hand, whereupon there pushed forward to her a certain horseman, who dragged with him a churl rope to his saddle bow. The knight was in bassinet and chainmail like the others, but his shield and pavone were emblazoned with arms betokening his higher rank. "Messer de Polwarth," said the lady, "is not this in sooth love's paradise?" "Certes, madam," he answered grimly, "it is the king's manor of Woodstock." She laughed, then stiffening suddenly in her saddle, pointed upwards. "Look," she said. A poising kite, as she spoke, had dropped to the wood edge, and thence rose swiftly with a dove beating in its talons. "Behold a fruitful omen," she cried, and turned on the hind. "Dog, where lies the garden?" De Polwarth struck the fellow a steely blow across the scruff. "Answer, beast." The man, a sullen, unkempt savage, pointed with an arm like a snag. "Down yon, a bowshot from the lodge. Bone by the waterside." The lady nodded, her eyes fixed in a sort of smiling trance. She was Eleanor of Aquitaine, no less, the divorced wife of France, the neglected and embittered Queen of England, and she was at this moment on the verge of flight to those rebellious sons of hers who conspired in Guienne against their father. But before she fled, she had just one deed of savage vengeance to perpetrate, and of that she would not be balked, though to accomplish it she must ride across half England. Somewhere, she knew, in this place was situated that house of wonderful working, wrought like unto a knot in a garden, where lived her hated child rival, that beautiful frail Rose of the Cliffords who had borne the king a son. So much the worse for her, so much the worse. The queen descended to earth, spiritually and literally. She was dressed like a queen in a belted blue robe latticed with gold, and a long purple cloak over. A jeweled coronet embraced her headcloth, and the headcloth her face. The rim of hair that showed under was still, for all her 50-odd years, crow-black. Her color was high, her frame masculine, the prominence of her lower lip gave her a cruel expression, and without belying her. "Nay, De Polwarth," she said as the knight made a movement to dismount. "No hand in this but mine." He retorted gruffly, "The place is reputed impenetrable." She smiled. "Hate will find out a way. Rest you here till I return." Never to be gainsaid, she went off alone by the streamside and soon disappeared among the trees beyond. Her way took her under the slope of the hill, which ran up to the king's manor. At first, looking through the branches, she could catch glimpses of the strong, irregular pile, budding like a mountain crag from the forehead of the green height. But in a little, the density of the trees increasing, the house was hidden from her view, and she had only the thick, towering woods and the little stream for company. On and on she went, resolute to her purpose, thrilled with some presentiment of its near accomplishment, and suddenly a white rabbit ran out from the green almost under her feet. She stopped dead on the instant, and as she stood motionless, the thicket parted near the bole of a great beech tree hard by, and a little boy slipped out into the open. He was pink-cheeked, saxon-haired and eyed, a shapely mannequin of 5 or so. Intent on recapturing his pet, he did not at first notice the stranger. But when he turned, with the bunny hugged in his arms, he stood rosily transfixed. In a swift stride or two the queen was upon him, cutting off his retreat. She stooped with a little exultant laugh. "What is thy name, sweet imp?" she said. He pouted, half frightened but still essaying the man, rubbing one foot against the opposite calf. "Willie Clifford, madam," he said, wondering for a moment at her crown, but then panic overtook him. "Nay, Willie," said the queen, holding him with a hand that belied its own softness, "I like thy tunic of white lawn and thy pretty shoon so latched with gold. Hast a fond mother, Willie, whose name I will guess of thee for Rosamond? And for thy father, Willie, do you see him often?" "He hath a crown like thine, but finer," said the child, "and when he comes he puts it on my head." Something in the staring face above him awoke his sudden fear. He began to struggle. "Let me go," he cried, "I want to go back to my Minnie." "Thy Minnie," said the queen. "One moment, child. Is that thy secret way behind the tree there?" "I will not tell thee," cried the boy. "I want my Minnie. Let me go." With one swift movement she tore the rabbit from his arms, and holding it aloft with her left hand, with her right whipped a jeweled bodkin from its sheath at her waist, and stabbed the little white body, stabbed it. Then she flung the convulsed in crimson-ed thing to the ground, and resheathing the weapon, held the child with a stare of fury. The swiftness, the savagery, the dreadful novelty of the act had had their purposed effect on him. His eyes widened, his throat swelled, but the scream to which he was on the instant impelled never came. His little soul was paralyzed, he was utter slave to horror. If she had told him at that moment to lie down and go to sleep, he would have tried to obey her will, though the unuttered sobs were half bursting his bosom. "Now," she said, "now," panting a little. "Seest thou, harlot's whelp? Cross me again, and so shalt thou be served. Wait here, move one step hence and thou darest, until I come again." She cast one final look of menace at him, then, stepping to the beech tree, parted the green and disappeared. It was a cunning blind, as she had expected. The great trunk was so packed amongst the thickets of the hillside that none would have guessed its concealment of a scarce discernible track which threaded the matted growths above and behind it. Mounting by this, the malign creature came suddenly upon a broken opening in the rock, so mossy and so choked with foliage that its presence would have been quite unsuspected from the glade below. She stopped, she uttered a little gloating exclamation, for there, looped over a projection of the stone, was the end of a strong green thread hanging out of the darkness. The clue of which she had heard whisper with but small faith was actually in her hand. Providence had doomed the foolish mother to permit her child to sport with the very means designed against her own destruction. The cavity led into a ramification of passages, roughly trenched and hewn out of the calcareous slate of the hill. Occasionally roofed, mostly open, always tangled in foliage, and so cunningly devised to mislead that it had been near humanly impossible to resolve its intricacies without such guide to follow, the labyrinth led the queen by a complicated course to a sense of approaching light and release. And then all in a moment the thread had come to an end against a stake to which it was fastened, and there was a pleasant garden sunk in a hollow of the hill, and a fair young woman with an awaiting, somewhat troubled expression on her face standing hard by. She had evidently spun the clue, and returned the first by it from the glade, to make sport for her little man. The intruder took all in at a glance, the expectant figure, the quiet inaccessible pleasaunce, the roof of a gilt pavilion rising, a long stone's throw away above the branches of a flowering orchard, dominating all and hiding this lovely secret in its lap, the wooded hill crowned by its protecting keep. The young woman, with one startled glance, turned to fly, but in the very act, staggered by a recollection, turned and came towards the queen, a hand pressed to her bosom. She was a frail thing in the ethereal as well as the worldly sense, fragile, it seemed, as china and as delicately tinted. All pink and cream, with pale golden hair, her darker eyebrows were the only definite note of color in a thin face. Even her long robe of pale green suggested the anemia of tulip leaves forced into premature growth. "A weak craft to have borne so huge a sin," said Eleanor as the girl approached. She eyed her with malignant scorn, her under lip projecting. "So wanton," she said, "dost know the wife thou hast wronged?" The other gave a little mortal start and cry, "The queen," and could utter no more. A small, hateful laugh answered her. "The wife fool, the she-wolf against whom you thought to guard your fold with straws. Why, look at you, I could peel you in my hands a bloodless stalk without heat or beauty. Spare me. I, as the wolf spares the lamb, the hawk the wren. Let me look on you. So this is a king's fancy. I could have wrought him better from a kitchen scrub. Quick. I am in, I have no time to lose, and thine has come. Poison or steel, make thy choice. Oh, madam, in pity. My heart, I have been weak and ill, I shall not vex thee long. God's blood. And balk my vengeance. Come, poison. Oh. What poison? Why, that thou art betrayed, supplanted. Another leman lies in thy bed, wife to one bluet, a willing cuckold. Drink it, thy desertion, to the dregs. Sin must not beshrew sin. It is bitter to the death, but I drink it. O thou toad! Thou wilt not die, for all thy stricken heart. Will this kill thee then? She whipped out the red stiletto. Rosamond uttered a faint shriek. Blood! The queen brandished it before her eyes. I met thy whelp in the glade. It was he who betrayed the way to me. The girl gasped and tottered forward. I led him to his death. Monster, thou hast killed my Willie, my boy, my one darling. She made an effort to leap forward, swayed, and fell her full length upon the grass. The queen, softly replacing her blade, stood staring down. No sound or movement followed on the fall. Stooping, she gazed long and silently into the thin face, then without a word, turned and retreated as she had come. The boy was standing, white and tearless, by his dead rabbit, as she parted the leaves and slunk forth. Go to thy mother, child, she whispered, hoarse and small. She is ill. Topic: Maid Marian. Master K, are you my friend? Hear me vow it, madam. Alas, what vow? That I am your friend. Can you so perjure yourself? Are you not the king's friend? Oh, yes, indeed. How can you be his friend and mine? Why, as the bee's the flower's friend. I carry messages of love. Does he ask mine of me? Just that, madam, only your love, no more. No more? You say well. Why, truly, my love were a little thing to be valued at no more than a man's base desire. The man is the king, madam. His desire is great like himself. The king is the man, sir, and the man is hateful to me. Will you tell him so, and be indeed my friend? It would serve you ill, madam. Will he force me? Alack! I will kill myself. Nay, that you shall not. Save you hold your breath and die of your own sweetness like a rose. No other way, be assured. He will wear you in his bosom first. God! Dear Master K, good Master K, sweet gentle friend, let me kill myself. I must not. But to leap from the wall. It is a little way, but a step, and to save me hell. You would not have me burn forever. I would have you reasonable, madam. She had fallen on her knees to him, this Maud Fitzwalter, fair daughter of Robert the Baron, who was to come to head the revolt against the infamous king. Her long white fingers plucked at his sleeves, her eyes sought his eyes imploringly. He drank of them, lusting in their passionate appeal. She was called Madeleine La Belle, and to see her was to think of spring with its crab blossoms against a blue sky, its glow and youth and waywardness. There is a lack of the sense of symmetry in love that makes his sweetest faces out of drawing. And yet one never doubts but that they are love's faces, as endearing as they are faulty, and for their very faultiness most lovable. His drawing, I say, may be defective, but he knows the trick of lip and eyelash to a curve and how to snare men's hearts thereby. And so, while we criticize his work, saying that this or that line goes astray, we would not have it turned by a hair's breadth nearer the truth, lest we should miss love in aiming at perfection. Such a face was Maud's, framed in its yellow braids so long that, parted from her forehead and plaited in with a cord of gold, they almost touched the ground when she stood up. For the rest, her simple tunic was green, and clasped loosely at the hips by a belt of jeweled gold, the slack of which hung low. Madeleine La Belle she was called, or Passerose, for the sweetness of her Saxon face and the Saxon blue of her eyes. But most of all she herself loved her name of Maid Marian, given her in those green holts and brakes of Sherwood whither she had followed her own true love, the outlawed Earl, and whence in a dire moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.